So we went on a helicopter to see what SpaceX is doing in Florida, and what we found is nothing but incredible. Starships are about to be produced here, and soon the place might even triple in size. Let's dive right in. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. Today we have some unique stuff to talk about. Our first ever Why a Helicopter Ride brought new insights, and we can now see where SpaceX's efforts in Florida are going. Starship updates. SpaceX's Starship progress at Kennedy Space Center is becoming increasingly apparent. Since Elon Musk's team already knows how to build a Starship production site, progress at Roberts Road is faster than it initially was at Starbase, Texas. We took the time to do our first ever Y flyover at Kennedy Space Center. I know, it was about time, right? We had to wait for this guy. Blame it all on him. Thank you for flying with us, Grandpa Joe. Follow him on Twitter at Grandpa Joe for the occasional space geek tweet. The large gallery is available on Patreon already, and on the next flight, these galleries will also be available for YouTube members. Bear with us, we're still organizing things here. In short, we will make this a regular thing from now on, likely every week. The pictures will be released to all channel supporters in full resolution, so this is a lovely new incentive for those looking to support us here at Y and at what we're doing. Either click the join button under the video or the Patreon link in the description to join in on the fun. But now let's see what we found. First of all, I'd like to start this one with a question that's asked a lot. Where exactly is Roberts Road? Where is SpaceX building the Florida Star Factory? This is the advantage when you can call the shots. You can choose what to talk about. So to give you an overview of what you can see in this single picture alone, I'll go from left to right. We have the VAB as a suitable location marker. NASA's most iconic building is so large that it is hard to miss. Behind that, on the coast, we have Pad 39B. This is where NASA is getting ready for Artemis 1 and the first ever SLS launch towards the moon. Net August 2019. And with a bit of luck, I can talk about it on site. In the center of the picture, on the coastline, we have SpaceX's Pad 39A. The launch tower, and even from this distance very visible, the second Mechazilla with 5 segments stacked now. And in the foreground, of course, Roberts Road, SpaceX's Star Factory at Kennedy Space Center. Up close, it reveals so many details that I could probably fill an entire episode with it. Actually, I might do that at some point in the future. For now, let's get some names straight. Up top, we have Hangar X. A common mistake is counting this into the Star Factory. This is a brand new building where SpaceX refurbishes Falcon 9 boosters and prepares them for launch. You can even see what's likely Falcon 9 booster B1051 sitting in front of it. And the place is bustling, as SpaceX is again breaking launch cadence records this year with 36 launches in the books. This could be the first year to hit 50 plus launches in one year alone. And after the two retention ponds, we have the actual Starship facility, the KSC Star Factory. Here you can see the remaining Mechazilla segments for Pad 39A in various stages of construction. Segment number 8 has the lowermost frame built, and the crown segment number 9 is also visible. Mechazilla 2 is almost stacked, but it's missing a few parts. In a side view, we can see it better. Chopsticks, the carriage system, and the upper quick disconnect arm. And the chopsticks are pretty much done and very different from what we can see at Starbase, Texas. They are much shorter, like tiny T-Rex arms. The reason might be simple. SpaceX might not plan on catching Starships and boosters at Pad 39A. There are two main reasons for this. Do you like today's episode so far? Then click the like button right now, subscribe to the channel, or become a channel member by hitting the join button right below the video. Or head over to Patreon by following the link in the description and become an active supporter. Or buy yourself a new shirt in the YWear store if you fancy cool space merch. Thank you so much.
What?
It would endanger the current launch infrastructure at the world's only human-rated space launch pad. Both the Falcon 9 infrastructure and the Starship pad are very close together. Lonomatico 3D and Too Legit to Quit 3D have been busy for all of us again. This is an unfinished work in progress render I got exclusively for today's episode, as I constantly kept bugging the two. Thank you guys, you rock. It perfectly shows what I mean. Even though Pad 39A is large, it was initially meant for one rocket, not two. We're talking around 200 meters between the two launch towers. If anything went wrong on a catch attempt, the Falcon 9 launch tower would likely take damage. NASA would lose access to the ISS for crew and cargo if this happened. SpaceX doesn't need to catch Starships and Super Heavy boosters at Pad 39A. Kennedy Space Center's infrastructure can easily handle a rocket transfer. Falcon 9 has separate landing zones too. This is likely SpaceX's plan for Starships as well. Remember episode 228? Zach from CSI Starbase found parts of another Mechazilla. Could this one be for catch attempts at Kennedy Space Center and not for another launch pad, as we speculated? Let me know your thoughts in the comments. How would you do it if you were in charge? Looking at the Star Factory itself, one of the most exciting objects on site reveals that SpaceX is making fast progress. In fact, faster than at Starbase, Texas. It's unknown if this is just due to having more workforce at the Cape or a faster supply of materials, but the Starship Factory itself is going up fast. The first part of the building, the framework for what's likely going to be ring segment manufacturing, is already standing. The foundation for the next part is being poured. The foundation pillars for the entire building are already done or being worked on. SpaceX means it. Right next to the main Star Factory building, foundation work for the first of two Starship and Super Heavy high bays is being worked on. Judging by its footprint, this high bay will likely be roughly the same size as the high bay at Starbase, Texas. Right next to the unfinished Mechazilla segments, foundation work for the second high bay can also be spotted. So, judging by what we saw at Roberts Road and in person for the first time, SpaceX is only months away from starting Starship production at Kennedy Space Center. Two Starship factories. To quote a famous video game character, double the launch sites, double the fun. And here's the next topic for the Florida Star Factory. This is just a tiny part of what SpaceX wants to build out at KSC. Up to 100 additional acres are being talked about. This is what's being proposed right now. In white, you can see the currently leased area. This is where SpaceX is currently building its Star Factory. The purple outline shows the proposed extra space for a Starship Factory expansion. Here's a picture from our July 31st flyover. Let's mark the rough position of where the expansion would be built. That would give SpaceX roughly the same area they have at Starbase, Texas, right now. A fully fledged Starbase in Florida. The road leading up to the VAB would be continued all the way up as well, giving SpaceX easy access to 39A and a future LC-49, which is supposed to be built north of Pad 39B. And the reasoning behind it is explained as well. The purpose of SpaceX's proposal is to consolidate SpaceX's Brevard County, Florida operations within a contiguous campus at KSC. This will increase operational capabilities, efficiencies, and cost-effectiveness of SpaceX's operations. So SpaceX plans to do exactly the opposite of what an old space rocket manufacturer would do. Instead of being proud of having jobs in all sorts of different US states, SpaceX is trying to have it all in one place. Close together, Starbase manufacturing, Starship construction, maybe even the headquarters. As much as possible of it should be in one place to streamline SpaceX's facilities in support of optimizing production and launch of their reusable launch vehicle fleet. Smart thinking from a company that wants to lead humanity into its space traveling future. Next up, we have a double feature. Two launches are coming up that couldn't be more interesting to watch. We are drawing closer to one of those rare double launch days at KSC. A paradise for space enthusiasts and lots of work for the crews at Kennedy Space Center. On the morning of August 4th, we'll see SBIRS GEO-6 go up on a United Launch Alliance Atlas 421 from Slick 41. It's a launch for the US Space Force, carrying the 6th space-based infrared system geosynchronous Earth orbit missile detection and early warning satellite. Whoever came up with that name? Since the payload goes into a geosynchronous orbit, separation will occur 3 hours after liftoff. The next launch on the same day will be Korea Pathfinder Lunar Orbiter going up on a Falcon 9 from Slick 40. It's South Korea's trip to the moon, which could be an essential one. Danuri, which is a combination of the two Korean words dal, which means moon, and nuri, which means enjoy, is going to scout the moon for lunar resources. On the plan are materials like water ice, uranium, helium-3, silicon, and aluminum, which are very important for future settlement plans. It is a technology demonstrator in cooperation with NASA. Main goals? Development of critical technologies for lunar exploration, creation of a topographic map for future landing site selection, a survey of lunar resources, and development and validation of new space technologies. NASA's part in the mission is the so-called Shadowcam. By collecting high-resolution images of the moon's permanently shadowed regions, or PSRs, Shadowcam will provide critical information about the distribution and accessibility of water ice and other volatiles. The moon's PSRs never see direct sunlight and are illuminated only by light reflected from nearby topographic heights. This secondary illumination is very dim. To see details within the PSRs, Shadowcam was designed to be over 200 times more sensitive than previous imagers like the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. The approximately 678 kilograms heavy KPLO will stay in a circular lunar orbit at a height of 100 kilometers above the surface, and the mission lifetime is set for 1 year. These kinds of missions are no coincidence. The world is looking at Moon and Mars in greater detail than ever before, and the probes sent out are connected to future plans for crewed missions. The space industry is getting ready for the next giant leap, this time to stay. Humanity is learning how to deal with new frontiers, and learning has always been our strong suit. So why not continue? Brilliant, today's sponsor, is an expert in effective and interactive learning. It's here for you to try out. Brilliant is the best tool I know for breaking down complex STEM topics for you to learn effortlessly and effectively. Courses like scientific thinking, math, computer science, and logic will make you understand the world and challenge you to learn new things in a visually stimulating, bite-sized, hands-on approach. Even though their courses are thorough, Brilliant offers you a low-pressure environment. It's not about grades. Help is always around the corner. At Brilliant, you learn intuitively and with fun. Use Brilliant between other activities, as I do. Walk a little, learn a little. Relaxing is so important. Learning with Brilliant is fun.
It is fun!
To get started for free, visit brilliant.org/whataboutit or click on the link in the description, and the first 200 of you will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. You learn something new every day, and in return, you help What About It as well. First of all, I'd like to start this one with a... incredibly apparent. I know, it was about time, right? Star Factory.